Yes. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Good evening, everybody. Good evening. Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
How is everybody? How are you?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hello, Facebook. Hello, Sister Jones. How are you? Hello, Brother Martin. How are you? Oh, my gosh. I'm excited. Hello, hello, hello. Hello to everybody. I am Prophetess Angel, and I have missed you all week. I have missed you guys all week. Oh my goodness. I don't even know where to begin, y'all. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let me just wait a few more minutes to get some more people.
You are now unmuted.
Get some more people on the call. I don't know what's going on with my phone. Just let a few more people dial in. Let a few more people get on the Facebook Live, and we'll get started. I'm excited. I'm calling, for those of you who are on the prayer call, I'm calling this vision from a prophetic perch on tonight. Those on Facebook already know because I posted it, but you guys didn't get a chance to see. So I'm calling it vision from a prophetic perch. And tonight we're going to get on the wall. Y'all know September, I said, is the month to get on the wall. We're getting on the wall again. I was on the wall at Saturday at midnight, and there were some who called in. We were on the wall. We were triumphing in the spirit. We were praying for 1 hour, and I had a good time being on the wall. God showed us so much. We'll be on the wall again on Saturday at midnight again. For those of you that want to join, just call the line at midnight and come on in with a prayer. Come on in and pray. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm just getting my I gotta get my atmosphere right. I've been busy. I'm getting my atmosphere right, trying to get together. I have a book that's another book, actually. This is my second book that's getting ready to come out. And so my publicist, she is on me. She's like, I need you to send me X amount of chapters by XYZ time. So I'm going to be up till midnight again trying to submit some more chapters for my book. But I've been busy, y'all. I've been busy. And so I want you to get your Bibles. I want you to get your notebooks. Get all your material, you know, don't come on this line empty-handed. Come on with some stuff. Come on, come on, come on. Go get your stuff. Whatever is a distraction, right now I'm asking you to, whatever clutter, whatever you got going on, let's get our atmosphere right. Let's get it right. Even myself, I have to get my atmosphere right because I had a lot going on today and I'm trying to settle my spirit. We got to settle our spirits, calm our spirits. Whatever kind of day you had, don't bring it tonight when we worship. Don't bring it when we're trying to learn. Don't bring it when we're trying to study. Don't bring it when we're interceding. I got something I want to say. I'm going to say it now, and I'm going to say it again later. But I'm waiting for her to get on the line. She's not on yet, but I'm waiting for this young lady is, I think, 78 or 79 years young. She's in the nursing home. Y'all may know her. I call her Mother Helen. She is in the nursing home, and they are experiencing a whole lot of just everything right now at the nursing home. And they kind of went through some stuff where they had to throw away stuff. And so she is in need of shoes. And so anybody that would like to sew into the elderly, you know, we all are supposed to take care of them. We are supposed to watch over them. That is our duty as the church to look after them. So if anyone would like to, because we cannot go into the nursing home, what I'm doing is anyone that would like to, I have several who already said on Friday when they get paid, they want to sow a seed. They're going to cash at me a seed so that I can purchase Sister Helen some shoes. We're trying to get her at least two pairs, something comfortable that she can walk around in. They threw away all her shoes. Also, they threw away her books.
If you don't mind me, Prophet Angel, yes. I'm so sorry.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
What is your Cash App?
Oh, it is actually My Angel Caldwell. It's capital letters for the first three letters. So capital M, capital A, capital C, My Angel Caldwell. That's what the, yes, with the dollar sign.
Okay, at the end?
At the beginning, dollar sign, capital M, Y, capital A, N G E L, and then capital C, all together, one word.
Okay.
My Angel Caldwell.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, no problem. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I pray God rewards your seed. I pray that He doubles, that favor is in your house, you and your children. I speak Proverbs that God will expand and increase your territory. I pray a prophet's reward, and I pray a righteous man's reward over that seed. And any other seeds that come through for Sister Helen, we would like to try to surprise her by ordering her two pairs of shoes. And also maybe another Bible, some reading material, her Bible, some things were thrown away due to some pest control that they had to do in the nursing home. And so we don't want her to be without. She may be joining us in a minute. She's trying to figure her way out to get on, but I'm sure she will be blessed to know that the church is looking out for her. Amen. Also, for some reason, the Lord has taken me back to the book of Judges. So we're going to be in Judges again tonight. I know last week we were in Judges chapter 6. But like I said, let me get my atmosphere together. Let me calm my spirit. Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for each and every viewer that is watching right now, that is on the live feed. I thank you for every listener that has called in on tonight. Father, we lift up Mother Helen to you, oh God, as she is in this crisis in a quarantine nursing home. Father, we lift up every elderly that right now is going through because they cannot see their families. Father, we lift them up that right now the only means of communication they have is the phone. So Father, right now we just ask that you send your angels, that you go before them in the forefront, oh God, that you encourage them, lift them up, oh God. Father, increase their spirit. Father, even broaden their horizon, even beyond the walls, even though they cannot set foot out of them. Father, I even pray over the nurses, over the staff, over the directors, over everyone that comes in contact with them. Father, because they right now are the only people that they get to see. So, Father, the last thing we want is for them to come in with a contrite spirit, with a bitter spirit, Father, with a deadly spirit. We thank you right now, oh God, that the people that work with them, Father, that they will have such an inkling to take care of them, that they will nurture them, oh God, that they will protect them, oh God, because they will reap what they sow. So, Father, we pray that they will receive and they will reap a righteous reward. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we pray for every child right now, oh God, that is doing remote learning. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, as we've heard even on the news, some places and some counties, Father, even in Lee County, where there's been a breach in the Google Classrooms, oh God, where there's someone hacking into the Google Classrooms, uploading things that should not be seen by children. So, Father, right now we break and we bind it and it shall be loosed in the name of Jesus. Father, that there will be no hindrance in the learning of the children on this year, oh God, during this pandemic. Father, we thank you you right now that you hear us. Father, we thank you right now that you are inclining your ear to us. Father, we thank you right now, oh God, that you are turning your eye to see us, oh God. We thank you right now that you are in the throne room and our prayer has made it through. We thank you that our prayers are not held up in the second heavens. Father, we thank you that angels have taken our prayers, oh God, and we have, and they have lined up with your will. Father, we thank you, oh God, right now that the angels are surrounding us, each and every person right now that is in their home, that is on live, that is on the call right now, that are faithful, oh God. Father, I ask that you bless your faithful warriors, oh God. I ask that you bless your faithful viewers, oh God, your faithful listeners, oh God, that they will not only, Jesus, hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you. We thank you, oh God. We thank you right now, Father. We thank you, oh God. We declare and we decree favor in our households, favor over our children, favor right now, oh God, like never before. Father, we are looking for unadulterated favor, oh God. We are looking for favor that has not been manipulated, that has not been maneuvered, Father, that has not been touched, but favor that comes straight from the throne room, oh God. We are looking for secrets, deep secrets, oh God, to be revealed unto us, as Daniel 22 has spoken of. Father, we thank you right now that we will be entreated by your favor, Psalms 119 and 58. Father, we thank you, oh God, Jesus, that you will open up our eyes and we will behold wondrous things, oh God. Psalms 119 and 18. Father, we thank you for extraordinary favor. Father, we thank you that we are highly favored. Luke 1:28. Father, we bless your name. We thank you, oh God, for increase. We thank you, oh God, that you are expanding our territory. We thank you that you are expanding our entreating in our health, oh God, that you are expanding our growth, that you are expanding our reach. We thank you, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you that Psalms 37:26 says that even our seed is blessed. Jesus. We thank you, oh God, that Luke 1:48 says that all generations shall call me blessed. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. Proverbs 10:22 says that let your blessings make rich and addeth no sorrow. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you, oh God. 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 We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you, oh God. Father, now we ask that you settle here. Settle here, Rabbi. Settle here, Jesus. Settle here, Jehovah Rapha, because we don't know what each individual needs you as. So, Father, we need all of you here, Jesus. Father, we ask that you settle here as the vine. Some of us need to get realigned with you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we decree Psalms 41 and 11 that our enemies will not triumph over us. Jesus. Some of y'all need to make that a part of your daily decree your enemies will not triumph over you. Psalms 41 and 11. Father, we thank you for the decrees. We thank you, oh God, for the declarations of your word. Now, Father, we ask on tonight that you have your way as all of your watchmen has lined up on the wall. It's shaking about Jesus. So, Father, give each and every one of them their assignment. Give each and every one of them where they shall go. Give each and every one of them a breath of your wind and let them blow in which direction you will have them to go. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, I feel so led right now to pray for our teenage boys, teenage young males. Father, right now, especially during this time, I pray direction over them. I pray that they will not get lost in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray that they will know and they will have their way. Father, I thank you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I thank you, oh God. I thank you, oh God. I thank you, oh God, that our young people will not fall by the wayside, that our young people will not be left behind, but that our elderly and our olders and our seniors and our mature and our seasoned will help pick them up, will help guide them in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I decree Genesis 48 and 20 that you will make me as Ephraim and Manasseh. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. And Father, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you, oh God, that you are driving out the darkness. We thank you, oh God, that you are increasing us more and more and more. We thank you, oh God, that you are opening up our eyes. We decree, we declare these things in Jesus' name. Father, we confess that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Father, we thank you right now that our weapons of warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. We thank you, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, this has been a time of trial and error. But Father, I decree that we will come out stronger than the strong. Father, we will not be the least of the least, but we will be of the strength and of strong and of the mighty, of mighty men and mighty women of valor. Hallelujah, Jesus. I decree Galatians 3:13 that we are free of the curse of the law. We have been redeemed from the curse of the law. Hallelujah, Jesus. And we are redeemed from spiritual death. Some of you have been redeemed from spiritual death, and you will not die before your time. I decree life, that you shall live and not die, in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. I thank you, Father. We decree John 10:10 that we have life and more abundantly. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I decree, Father, 1 John 1:7, Father, that we walk in light and the blood of Jesus cleanses me. Now, Father, purge us with hyssop and we shall be clean. Wash us and we shall be washed. Save us and we shall be saved, in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, oh God. Father, this is our decree, and we ask that you incline thy ears to us, oh Lord. Incline thy ears to us, oh Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Remember, we said prayer has an odor. Prayer has a smell and prayer has a praise. So sometimes when we pray, we got to just lift up our hands so that when it reaches the throne room, that it is not lacking or missing anything that will cause it to be hindered, that will cause it to be delayed or even rejected. You want your prayer to be heard and you want it to be honored. So Father, we lift up this prayer with a praise. Father, for every hand right now that is outstretched towards you, Father, I ask that you hear their cry, oh God. I pray that their aroma is sweet in your nostrils. I pray that they're saturated, oh God, in nothing but sweet stuff. I pray, oh God, that they are saturated, oh God, and blossoming, oh God, in such a sweet, savory aroma. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let this decree, let it be savory in your sight, oh God. Let it be sweet in your nostrils, oh God. Let it have a worship attached to it, oh God. And let the broth not be tainted. Let the broth not be nasty, but let the broth be edible. Strong enough. But humble enough to be poured on the rock. Hallelujah. 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 Good evening, men of God. Men of God, how are you guys on tonight? Hallelujah. I thank you for joining us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm feeling the anointing, but it's not how I want it yet. So I'm going to tarry just a little bit. I'm going to tarry just a little bit. I feel it in my legs, but I need to feel it in my hands.
Bless you,
Lord.
Bless you.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Yes, you can have it. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Yes, you can have it. Yes, you can have it. There he is. Hallelujah, Jesus. There he is. Yes, you can have it. Yes, shake it up. Yes, shake it up. So shake it up. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, she can amash a quota both sides of the Ramosaka. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we wait on you. Father, we wait on you. Father, we wait on you. Father, we wait on you.
Thank you.
Yes, you can. Ooh, do you feel him? Can you feel him? Can you feel him? Can you feel him? Can you feel him? Father, we wait on you. Yes, you can. Holy Spirit, move in this place. Hey. Holy Spirit, move in this place. Yes, you can. Jesus. Father, you are welcome here. You are welcome here, Holy Ghost. Jesus. Holy Spirit, move in this place. Move in this place. Hey, God. Holy Spirit, move in this place. Hey! Woo, Jesus. Move on me, God. Yes, Jesus. Take joy in me, God, Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Holy Spirit, move. Oh, God, I thank you. That's a prophetic decree when the soul come in your spirit. Holy Spirit, move. Jesus. Hey, God. Holy Spirit, move.
Come on, Daddy, come on. Jesus. Come on, Daddy, come on. Come on, hallelujah.
Hey, God.
It's my mama, my mama.
Hey! Hallelujah. 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 Holy Spirit, move. Hallelujah, Jesus. Holy Spirit, move. Yes, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. That's it, people of God. That's it. That's it. That's it. Hallelujah. 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 That's it, people of God. Move. Move in this place. Move in this place. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, hallelujah. I feel such a worshiping spirit. There's such a worshiping spirit in the atmosphere. God said when you send up your prayers, you got to send it with a worship. You can't just send it up naked. You got to send it with a worship. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Father, your people are worshiping you. Come see about them, oh God. Come see about them, oh God. Yes, hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Woo, Jesus. Father, we'll stay right here as long as you tell us. Father, we'll stay right here as long as you are with us. Father, we'll stay right here as long as you are pleased with our worship. Father, we won't move until you tell us to. Father, we'll stay right at your feet, oh God. We'll worship, oh God, at your feet. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. We'll stay right here, oh God. Father, we're in a season where we don't want to do it alone. Father, we're in a season where we can't do it alone. Father, we're in a season where we're done trying to do it alone. Father, we're in a time where we need your spirit, oh God. We need to see your feet move, oh God, so we can pick ours up with you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. There's nobody like our God. There's nobody like our God. There's nobody like our God. Jesus. Nobody like our God. There's nobody like our God. There's nobody like our God. We give so much attention to everything around us and everyone around us, and we give him the least amount of our attention, and he's the one that gives the most to us. He's the one that pours out the most on us. He's the one that does the most for us and those attached to us and everything assigned to us, and we give him so little of us. We don't even set time aside to just worship him. Jesus. And so sometimes he makes you tarry because it sounds so good to him, because it feels so good to him. So sometimes he makes us tarry in our worship. And let me tell you, people of God, when he has the Spirit tarry like that, you can best be sure, you can bank on it that God received it, he heard it, and he's moving on it. Whatever you were just worshiping for, God said, declare it done. Decree it done. It should get by Jesus. He said, I've been waiting to hear from you all day. And now that I have your attention, God said, you now have my attention. It should get it. God said, I've wanted to talk to you all day. And now that you have my attention, oh God, I thank you. God said, now that I have your attention, guess what? He said, now you have his. See, you can't even have a conversation with him until he first receives you. You can't even begin to pray to him and expect a response until he mingles with you, until he dwells with you, until he abides with you. Remember, last week, Gideon laid out his broth on the rock, and the angel of the Lord had to come see if it was good enough to receive. And when it was, he said, the angel of God came back and talked with him and said, now this is how you do it. You got to first give God attention. Otherwise, you're just making sacrifices just to be making sacrifices. What good is to make a sacrifice if you're not going to make it where he can take it? You're just singing and talking to nobody. Jesus. Hallelujah. But nevertheless, when the spirit of worship settles and you yield to it, we could have just went on business as usual. There would have been no anointing on it. But because you allow him to have his way, that comes with rewards. That comes with benefits. Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless you, woman of God. Bless you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Sister Helen, I hear you. You missed it. You weren't on the line, but some people are they are sending in some donations for you so that we can get you some shoes. And whatever's left over, we're going to try to send you a Bible, another Bible. You said you wear a 9.5, right? Sister?
Yeah.
Okay. We got you. Leviticus 19:32 tells us that to stand up in the presence of the aged and show respect for the elderly. In doing so, we revere God. We reverence God in doing so. Hallelujah, Jesus. So, Father, I pray right now and over every seed that is sown on tonight. I decree Psalms 121 over every seed sown, that peace would be within your walls and prosperity within your palace. I decree Psalms 118, that God will send prosperity now. I'm declaring these over every seed sown. I decree Psalms 115 and 14 over the seed sown, that the Lord shall increase you more and more, you and your children. I also decree Psalms 92, that you will be fed and flourishing in the mighty name of Jesus. I decree Psalms 35, that God will take pleasure in your prosperity for every seed sown on tonight. Hallelujah, Jesus. Holy Spirit, you have your way, Holy Spirit. You have your way. Hallelujah, Jesus. God has something to say. And he has something to say because it's not him just talking just to be talking like some of us do. He's talking because there's something coming in October, November, and December. There's something that's coming. And so September, God is preparing us to be on the wall. Hallelujah. I don't know what that feedback is, but I bind it right now in the name of Jesus. I don't know what that static was. I don't know what that was. But God is wanting to say something. He's showing us some things that he needs to say. And it's not by chance or by coincidence that God has taken me back into the book of Judges. So if you will, please go to the book of Judges. Remember last week we were in chapter 6 and the Lord said to Gideon, he said, I will wait for you. Gideon asked the Lord to show him a sign. But then he turned around and told God, depart not. He said, don't leave yet. I pray thee until I come unto thee and bring forth my present and set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry until thou come again. So God told Gideon, he's going to wait for him to go get his offering and bring it back to him. And then not only did he wait, he brought the angel of the Lord to come see if it was good enough to take. And when he saw that it was good, the Bible says that he told him to present it under an oak tree. And the angel of the Lord took and touched it and took it. And then he departed out of Gideon's sight. Well, later in that same chapter, chapter 6, if you notice in verse 24 of chapter 6, Then Gideon built an altar there unto the Lord. And he called it Jehovah Shiloh. Unto this day, it is yet an Orpah of the Abarites. Verse 25 said, and it came to pass the same night that the Lord said unto him, take thy father's young bullock, even the second bullock of 7 years old, and throw down the altar of Baal that thy father hath, and cut down the groove that is by it. I'm going to skip a little bit because I got to get to chapter 7. But in chapter 6, after Gideon presented his offering, the Lord then told him to make, after he presented his offering, Gideon went and made another altar and he put a sacrifice of a young bullock on it of 7 years old. But then look at this in verse 26. It says, the Lord told him to build another altar, a second altar. And he said, and build an altar unto the Lord thy God upon the top of this rock, in the ordered place, and take the second bullock and offer a burnt sacrifice with the wood of the grove which thou shalt cut down. So the Lord told Gideon, go, I need you to make another altar, and this one I need you to tear down the false god. So the first one was to the Lord our God, then the second one was to tear down the fake god, the false god, the god of Baal. So look at, I want you to skip over a little bit to verse 30. Verse 30 says, then the men of the city said unto Joash, bring out thy son, that he may die, because he hath cast down the altar of Baal, and because he hath cut down the grove that was by it. Verse 31 says, and Joash said unto all that stood against him, will ye plead for Baal? Will you save him? He that will plead for him, let him be put to death while it is yet morning. If he be a god, let him plead for himself, because one hath cast down his altar. I was going to skip this and go straight to chapter 7, but the Lord said, no, you can't skip it, because all of it ties in to what I need my people to know. Just like the broth was important, this is important as well. Because when God tells you to set up an altar for him, you have to do it to the T the way he tells you to. Just the same, when he tells you to tear down something, You can't go around, cut the cracks, cut the corner, and try to, half do it. You got to still do that thing the way he says do it. So if God said, I need you to go up there at night, Jesus, you got to go at night and tear it down. You watchmen on the wall, if your watch time is at night, you can't be talking about, I'm going to just pray in the morning. No, there's an anointing on you that is set up to pray and watch at night. Hallelujah. Some of us have a grace to do both prayer watches. You can pray in the morning, you can pray at night. And I'm not talking about just your regular prayer time. You got to do that anyway. I'm talking about your watch time. That's different. Your prayer watch is different. It don't have nothing to do with you. It don't have nothing to do with people around you. Your prayer watch is to pull down, to bind up things that are in the spirit realm before they manifest in our realm. So your prayer watch has nothing to do with your regular prayer time. So if your prayer watch is at midnight, guess what, baby? You got to be on the wall at midnight. You can't go and say, well, I'm going to do it at 6. The Lord told Gideon, I want you to tear down this altar. And he said, I want you to go up there and I want you to do it at night. Hallelujah, Jesus. He said, go up. He said, I want you to go and I want you to tear it down. And look, Gideon said, that works. Because I'm afraid of my father. And I'm not trying to tear it down in the morning, no way. He said, I'm going to do it at night. And so now the people in the morning are telling them to bring him out so they can kill him. So Joash, his father, is telling them, look, if Baal is a god, he don't need none of y'all to plead for him. He can plead for himself. So in a way, Joash is kind of petitioning that y'all act like Baal ain't a real god. I mean, we know he's not. But the way they acting like, you know, like they know the truth. So Joash said, listen, will you plead for Baal? Will you save him? He that will plead for him, let him be put to death while it is yet morning. If he be a god, let him plead for himself, because one have cast down his altar. So I'm saying this to say, thank you, Holy Spirit. God said, those of you who have watch times at night, you are praying a different prayer than those who are on the wall by day. See, let me just tell you what just happened here. At night, Gideon tore down an idol. That means you got to tear down and uproot witchcraft, warlock. You got to cast down Satanism. You got to bind up idolatry. You got to bind all that stuff up in the night. And by day, guess what? The people wanted justice. In the morning, they were wanting justice. So that's two totally different things going on in different times of the day. And so verse 32 says, therefore, on that day, he called him Jerubbabel. He changed Gideon's name and called him Jerubbabel. He said, saying, let Baal plead against him. So Jerubbabel means let Baal plead, because he have thrown down his altar. Then all the Midianites and the Amalekites and the children of the east were gathered together and went over and pitched in the valley of Jezreel. If you haven't heard my teaching on being pitched, then I'm going to tell you real briefly. Pitch means you're covered in water. There's a place of water that you get ready to go into, and you get ready to go down, because the when you're pitched, it's usually followed by a valley experience. So they're getting ready to go into a valley and it's going to be filled with water. And we get ready to see that come to pass, that they're actually getting ready to go into a valley, and they're going to be tried by water. So their pitch is a spiritual thing. It's as much as it is natural, it's a spiritual thing too. Verse 34 says, but the spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon, and he blew a trumpet, and Abiezer was gathered after him. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to skip down a little bit. I'm going to just sum it up a little bit. From verse 34 to verse 39, basically what Gideon did was, the Lord told Gideon that he was going to deliver, he was getting ready to deliver the land into his hand. He was getting ready to give them, you know, give it over to him. And Gideon said, if this be true, Lord, he said, let me try you. He said, can I please just prove you? And if you don't believe me, verse 39 actually says, And Gideon said unto God, let not thine anger be hot against me, and I will speak but this once, and let me prove, I pray thee. So he wanted to prove God that God was really speaking to him. If you notice Gideon's character, he just did that before in verse 14 through verse 20. He was saying, he asked God then, if this is you talking to me, right? He said, then I pray you show me a sign. So now he's doing it again. Lord, I pray you show me a sign. Because remember, he never got his sign. He went and made an offering so that he can see the sign. Y'all can't miss that. You can't leave that part out. You can't forget that in verse 17 through verse 20, Gideon's offering is what caused verse 37 through 39 manifestation. This shit can't happen, Jesus. He prayed and he offered up a sacrifice with broth that smelled good, that tastes good, that was acceptable to the king's sight. The king being our Lord and Savior, the God Most High, Yahweh. He saw, the angel of the Lord saw that the broth was good to eat, good to smell, good to taste, good enough to pour out on the rock, his church. And so now, verse 37 through 39, Gideon is getting his answer. This is what the Lord tarried with Gideon for. So he got the answer. He put the fleece on the ground. Y'all, if y'all don't know the story, he put the fleece. And the first time he said, if the fleece is, if the dew is wringed out of the fleece, you know, he put it in a bowl of water. And if it was dry, he said, and the ground was wet and the fleece was dry, then he knew that was God. And Satan, then he reversed it. If the fleece was wet and the ground was dry, he knew that was God. So that's what that was. Let's start with verse 40 of Judges chapter 6. And God did so that night. For it was dry upon the fleece only, and there was dew on all the ground. There we go again with the night. I'm telling you this because this is where God took me to show the difference between what's happening in the night and what's happening during the day. Those of you who have nighttime prayer watches, what you pray at night is not going to be how you pray intercede in the day. It's just not. It's two different things going on, two different manifestations. The way God manifests himself in the nighttime, whoo, is powerful. Not that he doesn't do it, you know, by day as well, because we remember the pillar of fire that followed them at night and the cloud by day. We know that, but just think about it. A cloud versus fire, one is a little bit more dynamic. One is just a little bit more theatrical. It's a little bit more stuff going on, a little bit more exciting. So here we are, chapter 7. This is where we're going to be. Then Jerubbabel, who was Gideon, and all the people that were with him rose up early and pitched, there go that word again, y'all, and pitched beside the well of Herod. So we know what we say, you pitch, you're going to be near some water. So now we know that they're near some water. They pitched beside the well of Herod, so that the host of the Midianites were on the north side of them by the hill of Marah. In the valley. Now we know they in the valley too. What we say, when you pitch, when you see pitch, you can bank on a valley going to be nearby, and so is some water. You need pitch when you go into both of them places. And the Lord said unto Gideon, y'all going to have to read along this with me. And the Lord said unto Gideon, the people that are with thee are too many for me. He said, to give the Midianites into their hands. Let Israel vaunt themselves against me, saying, my own hand have saved me. Now, therefore, go to proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whosoever is fearful, whosoever is fearful and afraid, let him return and depart early from Mount Gilead. And there returned of the people 22,000. And there remain 10,000. Now, I know y'all done heard this story before, but I promise you, you ain't heard it the way I'm getting ready to teach it. There were 22,000 that said, I'm afraid. You said I can go. I'm leaving. You ain't got to tell me twice. They're not watchmen at all. But guess what? They were honest about it. They're like, I can't. That's not my watch. I can't do this. This not for me. So you, when you give the opportunity to go, they left. So now you got 10,000 that's like, they're not fearful. They just stupid. They bold and stupid because you don't even know what you're about to do and you signing up for it. So, and this is how you know they were stupid, because even after the Lord tried them, guess what? Only 300 out of the 10,000 remained. So that tell you a good bulk of them should have left with the other 22,000. But they didn't know it. See, you got some people who think they can do a thing until they're tried. Then you realize they really wasn't called to do this. Hallelujah, Jesus. So then it's verse 4 says, and the Lord said unto Gideon, the people are yet too many. Bring them down unto the water, and I will try them for thee. I'm going to repeat that. The Lord said unto Gideon, the people are yet too many. See, God knew what Gideon didn't, that they weren't already. Bring them down unto the water, and I will try them for you. See, you're going to need to be pitched, because you're about to be tried by the water. The water is symbolic to the word. You get ready to be tried. Will you stand? Let me tell you how the 300 survived. Let me tell you what they did, which is what you're going to have to do. All of you prayer watchmen, all of you on the wall. If you are part of the 300, you in the number. You're not one sent home. You're not one left behind, but you in the number. Keep reading. Bring them down into the water, and I will try them for you there. And it shall be that of whom I say unto you, this shall go with you, the same shall go with thee. And of whomsoever I say unto thee, this shall not go with thee, the same shall not go. Verse 5. So he brought down the people unto the water, and the Lord said, that's another thing, that's another word. When you're about to be tried by God and tried by water or by fire, you got to go down. That's not an up experience. That's a valley experience. Valley experience causes you to go down deep, and you're about to go in, and you're about to be tried. So twice the Lord told Gideon, bring them down into the water. Now he's saying it a second time. So he brought down the people unto the water. And the Lord said unto Gideon, everyone that lappeth of the water with his tongue as a dog lappeth, him shall thou set by himself. Likewise, everyone that boweth down upon his knees to drink. What kind of posture does that sound like to you? Prayer. Prayer. Amen. That sound like prayer. Everyone that gets down on his knees, God said, I can use you. Hey, shake it by Jesus. I can use you. And out of 10,000, that tell you, you do the math, you do the numbers. 10,000, only 300 get on their knees. 300. And so guess what? Guess what God did? He said, and the Lord said unto Gideon, boy, the Lord talking a whole lot to Gideon, by the 300 men that leapt will I save you and deliver the Midianites into thy hand, and let all the other people go, every man unto his place. The rest of you can go. I can't use you. You can't be a part of this victory. You can't be a part of this win. You can't be a part of this battle. Go on home. When God say he can't use you, that's not a good thing. Some people say, oh, well, they got spit. No. Let me tell you what the Bible says in the New Testament. When Jesus was hungry and he was walking and he found a fig tree along the path he was walking, he found no fruit on it. And guess what he did? He cursed it. He withered it up and cursed it. Why? Because you a fruit tree with no fruit. You got DNA in you to be fruitful, and yet you yield no fruit. Same with these people. You got in you a warfare spirit, because God has placed in us nothing that we that's above us that we can't do. Each and every last one of us under the unction of the Holy Ghost can go into warfare. Each and every last one of us can pray. Each and every last one of us can worship. But when you willingly choose not to learn how, God said, I can't use you. So he sent them home. So the 300, so the people took victuals in their hand and their trumpets, and he sent all the rest of Israel, every man unto his tent. My Lord. Victuals, that word victuals means provision. Where the people lack vision, where there's no vision, the people lack discipline. They cast off restraint. They perish. Victuals means provision. They took provision and their trumpet. You see, y'all got to see the pattern here. Everything that God puts in your hand is always followed with a worship. I don't care if it's prayer. I don't care if it's food. I don't care if it's a battle. I don't care if it's a victory. When they crossed over from the Red Sea, the first thing the prophetess Miriam did was have the people worship. A prophetic worship. So everything God does is followed by worship. You cannot be in the body of Christ and say you're not a worshiper. It don't, and you can't say you're a worshiper who's silent with it. That's like an oxymoron. Them two words that just don't go together. Quiet worship. What is that? Hallelujah, Jesus. No. Every time you see worship, what is the word? Help me, Holy Ghost. It's compared to the sound of a trunk. So that lets you know how loud it is. Jesus. So he said, and it came to pass the same night. Here we go. It's another night now. The same night that the Lord said unto him, arise, get thee down unto the host. He said, for I have delivered it into thy hand. Y'all watch Gideon. Watch this. But if thou fear, he said, to go down, go thou with Phurah, thy servant, down to the host. Oh my goodness. You ain't not never heard the Lord say, if you afraid, then you could go here. Like he actually gave Gideon a choice. He gave Gideon an option. Normally, you get a rebuke. The disciples were afraid in the storm. The Lord woke up. He rebuked them, the storm, the wave, and everything else. You get a rebuke. But here, because Gideon, the Lord already knows Gideon is timid. He's not, you know, how what we would call brave. So he really, really needs God to reassure him in everything. And God understands that. Guess what? Remember in chapter 6, the Lord called him a mighty man of valor. So he called him that. Why? Not because he's strong and brave, because he's the opposite. But in the spirit, he can be used as long as God shows him he's with him. He will allow God to use him. And you have some people like that. They just need a sign from God to know, and then they'll do it. They're not like most that are walk by faith. They really need God to show a sign. There was a disciple that was like that too. I think it was Andrew that was like that. So here we go. He says, go down with Phurah, thy servant, down to the host, and thou shalt hear what they say. God said, I'm going to let you hear something. I'm going to let you hear something that's going to encourage you. So sometimes God will send you to a service. God will even send you to this prayer line. He will send you to somebody's Facebook page. He'll send you to watch something because there's a word to encourage you. So he told Gideon, look at verse 11, and thou shalt hear what they say, and afterwards shall thy hands be strengthened to go down unto the host. Then went he down with Purah, his servant, unto the outside of the armed men that were in the host. So Gideon kind of liked that option because he was like, I'm not really ready to go and and fight the Midianites, even though you showed me the fleece, even though you came and took my sacrifice, even though you told me I'm going to win. Gideon said, that ain't enough for me. I kind of need some more convincing. So he went with his servant down. Look what he did, y'all. Verse 12. And the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the children of the east lay along in the valley. Remember, they got with them the people of the north. So you kind of got a north versus east thing going on here. He said, Amalekites and all the children of the east lay along in the valley like grasshoppers for multitude. They down in the valley and they got that thing packed out, ready to fight. They ready to have a rumble in the jungle. And I see why Gideon's scared. Gideon said, look, they laid out like grasshoppers. It's so many of them. For multitude. He said, and their camels were without number. That means for every camel, they got a rider. Somebody walked with them. Somebody rode on them. He said, and as the sand by the seaside for multitude. You got this huge army laid out. And he walking to go see what he need to hear to strengthen him. The Lord told him, go down there. I got something you need to hear. Look what he heard, y'all. Look what he heard. Verse 13. And when Gideon was come, behold, there was a man that told a dream unto his fellow and said, behold, I dreamed a dream. And lo, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the host of Midian and came unto a tent and smote it that it fell and overturned it that the tent lay along. And his fellow answered. So the guy had a dream and his friend get ready to interpret it. And his fellow answered and said, this is nothing else save the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. For into his hand have God delivered Midian and all the hosts. That's just like a dream interpreter. We just be so bold. We be like, look, that ain't nothing. That mean this. That ain't nothing. That ain't hard to interpret. That just mean this. He said, look how he responded. He said, this is nothing else. This is nothing. That's nothing. I can interpret that. That's nothing. This is nothing. Save the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash. So he told him the interpretation. But look at verse 15. And it was so. When Gideon heard the telling of the dream and the interpretation thereof, that he worshiped and returned into the host of Israel and said, arise, for the Lord have delivered into your hand the host of Midian. And he divided the 300 men into three companies. And he put a trumpet in every man's hand with empty pitchers and lamps within the pitchers. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm going, my last verse is going to be verse 19. But right here, the Lord told Gideon, go down in there in the camp, take your servant with you, take Pharaoh with you, and I'm going to let you hear something. And what he heard was a dream being told and the interpretation. This is why it is important when you tell a dream to someone to make sure either you or them can interpret it. Because you never know who's listening. And, hallelujah, Jesus, it sharpens your gift. It sharpens your gift. You can tell this, whoever this man was, the Bible don't even give him no name. It just said, and the fellow. You could tell he was a dream interpreter because that was nothing for him. He was like, this is nothing. But yet, we don't know much about him except that he interpreted a dream. Job says that dream interpreters are one in a thousand. So it's rare to find more than one at one time. Hallelujah. So verse 16 says, and he put a trumpet. Look at this. This for y'all that's getting ready to get on the wall. He put a trumpet in every man's hand with empty pitchers. You got to have an empty vessel, an empty cistern, an empty pitcher to carry the lamp. You cannot carry the lamp. You cannot carry the oil in a vessel that is already corroded and covered with all kind of stuff and gook and mess. You got to empty all that out. You need a pitch. You need a pitcher. And not just any pitcher. You need an empty pitcher so that you can carry the oil. You can carry the lamp. So he said in one hand he gave him the trumpet. The other hand he gave him a pitcher, an empty pitcher. And lamps within the pitcher. They put a lamp in the pitcher. Hallelujah, Jesus. And he said unto them, look on me and do likewise. And behold, when I come to the outside of the camp, it shall be that as I do, so shall ye do. When I blow with the trumpet, I and all that are with me, then blow ye the trumpets also on every side of all the camp, and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. Verse 19. So Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came unto the outside. My Lord, what happened to the 300? Where the other two go? He said, so Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came unto the outside of the camp in the beginning of the middle watch. Y'all see that? Of the middle watch. Of the middle watch. And they had but newly set the watch. And they blew the trumpets and brake the pitchers that were in their hands. Tonight, people of God, this is what the Lord is saying. Before you get on the wall, you have to follow these steps. You have to follow the necessary steps. It may not be in this particular order, but it has to be the way the Lord wants it to be. First, you have to have a sacrifice to him that proves you can start the watch. You get this? You see this? The watch didn't come before the sacrifice. The sacrifice came before the watch. In chapter 6, Gideon had to create a broth, and he had to create it right. He had to create it with unleavened cake, and he had to create it with a kid, meaning it was a young lamb. So how do you translate that for us today in 2020? I'm gonna tell you. The unleavened bread and the kid, the young sheep or the young lamb, represents you having to go before the Lord like a child. You have to be humble. You cannot go before the Lord thinking you got it all together. You got to go before the Lord and really be honest. Father, I'm going to use Solomon's prayer for example. The Lord came to Solomon in a dream and asked him, what did he want? Solomon said, I am young. I'm a novice. I do not know how to do this thing that you are calling me to do, which is be king. I'm too young to do it. I need wisdom. God was so pleased with him, not because he didn't ask for anything or because he was selfless. He was proud because he asked for wisdom. The Bible says it is more precious than rubies. So he, in God's sight, he asked for $1 million gift. Wisdom. And he was honest. God, oh my God. Y'all, God loved honesty. He loved humility. If my people that are called by my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face. God loves humility. He likes us to be like that of a child. Children, you know, they rely on us. They need us. So when they ask us for food, they are sincerely hungry because they can't do it themselves, young children. When they need to be cleaned, when they need to be fed, when they need to sleep, when they're tired, they cry because they need us. That's how God wants us to be. When Gideon went and got the unleavened bread and the kid, that was in essence him saying, I'm humbling myself and I'm giving you my best sacrifice. The best sacrifice you can give is obedience and humility. Secondly, he put the broth in a pot and he brought it out. The pot is symbolic to the vessel being empty. Can God fill you up? Jeremiah talks about the two evils that the people done against the Lord, and that was they did not go to him as the fountain of water, and they had broken cisterns. Broken cisterns mean you have a broken vessel, and God can't fill a broken vessel. He will not. He cannot. He doesn't. And so Gideon made sure he put it in a good pot. And he put the broth in a pot and he brought it to him under the oak and he presented it. And the angel of the Lord came and looked at it and he said, it was good. Take the flesh, take the cakes and lay them upon the rock. And he told him how to do it. He said, lay the flesh, lay the unleavened cakes and lay them upon this rock. Then he told him to pour out the broth. And the Bible says Gideon did so. You got to do it how God say. Y'all can't just be sacrificing how you want to sacrifice and think it's going to work. No, you really got to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and do what he say, how he say, when he say. If he say you in the night, you in the night. If he say you in the day, you in the day. Hallelujah, Jesus. Because I'm telling you, when you say I'm giving this to God, can I tell you something? You ain't got to be a prophet to know this. God going to come see it. He gonna come see it. When you say, Lord, I'm laying this out for you, whether good or bad, he gonna come look at it. So the least you want, if God gonna come see you, you want it to be a good visitation. You want it to be a blessed visitation. You want to see a manifestation as a result of the visitation. Hallelujah, Jesus. So when you get on the wall, before you get on the wall, check your broth, check your sacrifice. If the Lord say, I need you on the wall at night, remember he told Gideon, go tear down the altar of Baal at night. He ain't tell him get on the wall that day. Midday means, thank you, Holy Spirit. When it says, so Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came unto the outside of the camp. In the beginning of the middle watch. That's where we're at right now. The middle of the beginning of the middle watch. That's midnight to 3 o'clock. That's the middle watch. That's the third watch. That's the witching hour. We're going to talk about that just a little bit. Those of you who are on the wall at midnight, between midnight and 3 a.m. is the third watch of the night. That is called the witching hour. This watch is the darkest and most demonic part of the night, especially at midnight. Witches, warlocks, Satanists have found that they have fun. They're most fun. That they can get people to speak incantations during this part of the night. This is when people find the spirit of restlessness on them. The spirit of anxiety is unleashed. The spirit of worry is unleashed. And because it's dark, you got a lot of kids and adults too who are fearful of the dark. Spirit of fear is emerged. Spirit of pain. People are in the most pain at night than any time of the day. You got the most break-ins at night than any time of the day. Rape, robbery, murders, all these demons are unleashed at midnight. Not that they don't get to come out during the day, but they really rally together in groups at the midnight hour because there's more people up conjuring them. They're doing incantations and it makes the spell even more impactful. The devil operates at this time because this is the time that men are in a deep sleep. And there are not as many people praying to oppose him. You can read more about that in 1 Kings 3 and 20. Hallelujah. This watch calls for seasoned intercessors. 1 Kings 3 and 20 says, and she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me. And while thy handmaid slept and laid it in her bosom, and laid her dead child in my bosom. Mischief happens at midnight. Evil is concocted in the night. Hallelujah, Jesus. You must not be afraid of witchcraft during this watch. you will get sent home. In essence, this is just like Gideon. When the 10,000 was out there and the Lord said, I'm going to try him. Bring them down by the water. I'm going to try them. And he said, the ones who lapped up the water like dogs, he sent them home. He said, go back to your tent. But the ones who got on their knees, see, because you got to look, you got to think about it. How you drink your water says a lot to God. Are you watching? How you drink your water, it's not about just taking a glass of water and drinking. The water is symbolic to the word. Oh my God, thank you, Holy Spirit. When you drink your water, your word, are you watching while you drink? Eh, shake it up. By Jesus. Are you drinking while you, are you watching while you drink your water? God said, if you're not watching while you eat your word, if you're not watching while you pray, you might as well go home because all you're doing is drinking. That's how he divided them up, by how they watch. If they were watching right, there was a certain technique that the Holy Spirit was looking for. And the way they were doing it, the vast majority was wrong. As is today. The vast majority that are praying, they not watching. So they doing it wrong. You can't lap that water up like a dog and your face all in the water. You gotta have it where you cup it in your hand, you drink and you watch. Cup it in your hand, you drink and you watch. Cup it in your hand, you drink and you watch. Hallelujah, Jesus. So all watchmen, I'm telling you this because you don't say nobody didn't tell me. The Bible says it's better not to make a vow than to make one and not keep it. He also said in 1 Peter, it's better for those who don't know than those who know and don't do. When you know how to watch and you've been taught how to watch, God expect you to watch. He expects you to watch. He said, because now you have no excuse. You know how. You got the scripture. You know how. And he's expecting you to do it. Get your broth. Make sure it's right. Get your altar. Make sure it's right. Get your time. God's going to give you your time. And whatever time of the day or night, God is always bringing to your attention. I don't care if you always see 11:11. I don't care if you always see 3:13. I don't care if you always see 1:09. That's your prayer watch. Get on it. Pray. Get on the wall. Because in the spirit, that's what you're doing. In the spirit, if you can close your eyes and visualize in the spirit, you're on the wall on the east. Somebody's on the wall on the west. Somebody's on the wall in the north. Somebody's on the wall on the south. And in the spirit, everybody's on the wall watching. Praying, binding and loosing. Hallelujah. You cannot be afraid of witchcraft during this watch. You cannot be afraid of demonic entities during this watch. Why? Because when you are a seer, when you have vision from a prophetic perch, because that's what the wall is. When you are on the wall, you are on a prophetic perch. You are literally getting a panoramic visual of what's going on. And when you are on that prophetic perch, shake it about Jesus, my God, your vision intensifies. You're getting ready to see both good and bad things. But usually when you're on the wall, you're not going to see many angels. You're going to see a whole lot of demonic stuff. When you're on the wall, you're looking for the enemy. Look in your word. That's what they did. When the watchman was on the wall, they looked out and they yelled, I see a company of people. And the king would say, go see who it is. Ask them, do they mean good or are they here to fight? I'm telling you, when Jehu was coming towards the wall, that brother was no joke. That Jehu was a bad mamma jamma. When he started coming towards the wall, the watchman on the wall, they said, and Samuel, they said, I see a company. But I can't tell who it is. The king said, go look. Go see who it is. Go look. The first set went out. And they said, you mean us well or what? Jehu said, what you mean? Do I mean you well? What you think? He said, get behind me. And guess what the watchman did? Got behind him. They did not return back. They said, oh, you better have discernment. You better know whose side you better be on. So then when they didn't return, y'all got to go back and read that story. When they didn't return, guess what? The king sent out another group of watchmen. They said it again. Do you mean us well? He said the same thing again. What you mean? Do I mean you well? Get behind me. James said, he told the watchman, get behind me. And guess what they did? Got behind him. Hallelujah, Jesus. So when you on the wall, you got to know, you got to have discernment, because you're in a prophetic place. You're in a high place. When you are on the wall in that hour, you are literally where prophets stay most of their day. When you are on the wall for that 1 hour, you are seeing in a realm that prophets literally can interchange in like that, like the flick of a wrist. They can go in and out of that realm at will. That's their gift. That's the calling. That's the office. They could go in. They could tap in and out, in and out. They could come in like changing rooms, like going into the bathroom and coming out. They could go into that room and come out interchangeably. Seers. Not all prophets are seers, but every seer is a prophet. Seers can go in and out. In and out, in and out. Hallelujah, Jesus. So when you are on that wall, when you are perched from a prophetic view, you got to know what you're seeing. Jesus. You have to have discernment. When you get on that wall, you can't be saying, oh, I saw unicorns and doves and water and crows and pigeons. And you're going to be like, okay, you need to know what that is. What is all these birds? Some birds represent demonic spirits. Some birds represent angelic spirits. But you need to know what you're seeing. So you're not casting down something you're supposed to be blessing, and you're not blessing something that's supposed to be cast down. You got to know how to discern between the spirit. And you're going to, 2 Samuel tells you about David. David sat between two gates. Do you know the two gates? The watchman, when you are up on the wall, you are going to literally see a distinguishment between two gates. You're going to see two gates. You're going to have to distinguish between the spirit of God. Of course, you're going to have your own spirit, the spirit of flesh. You're going to have to, at this point, when you're on the wall, you cannot be in your flesh. There's no way you can go into a high place and be still in your flesh. God won't let you go there. You cannot have the veil pulled down and go behind that in your flesh. That requires a great amount of warfare, a great level amount of worship. You have to literally sacrifice to get into that high place. But once you're there, you're going to know you're there. You're going to know you're there. You're going to have visions. You're going to have... a deep sleep might fall on you, and you might dream of being in a actual war zone. You may feel, and what I mean by feel, you may pick up, the Lord may have you praying for, I'm going to just say Sister Susie. The Lord may have you praying for Sister Susie. You know Sister Susie, but out of nowhere, the Lord just say, start going in, bind up the spirit of oppression off of her. And all of a sudden, your left knee start aching. You in a high place. You're getting a manifestation of what Sister Susie's been dealing with. And now you can lay hand and you can intercede in the gap on your left knee and say, I command you to leave Sister Susie in the name of Jesus, because you felt it. Another way you may pick up a manifestation is hearing, seeing, tasting, smelling. All these senses. This is why I always tell watchmen, if you know you are a watchman, not just the intercessor, but you are a watchman on the wall. We all have a prayer watch hour. You don't have to be a prophet to be a watchman, but you do have to be obedient, and you have to be a believer to be a watchman. Those are the prerequisites. And when you are a watchman, you have to have, I tell them all the time, pray, anoint your eyes. I keep my little bottle of oil with me. Anoint your eyes, anoint your nose, anoint your ears, anoint your mouth, anoint your hands. That's taste, touch, eye, sight, smell. All five senses need to be activated when you are on a high place, when you are perched from a prophetic view. Gotta be. You can't have nothing tainted. You can't go in lopsided, y'all. You can't go in talking about I'm a seer, and then you can't hear the thing growling behind you. You gotta be able to, all of you gotta be workable. Because it's not gonna always manifest the same time. You may hear drums, and then you know somebody working root somewhere. You bind that up. Whatever you hear, see, smell, taste, touch in your prayer watch, that's what you bind up. But you got to listen. You got to hear it. You got to hear it. You got to distinguish between the spirit of God, and you got to distinguish between the spirit of the devil. If you are on the night watch, which is what we're talking about all of you who have the third prayer watch from midnight to 3 a.m. That's what we're talking about. I'm talking about all of you. If you have that prayer watch, I need for you to have on your spiritual armor. You got to have on your spiritual armor. Don't let nothing. And in a minute, before we close out, I'm going to pray the Ephesians 12 armor over you, because you're going to need that on. You need your Ephesians armor. You cannot go in there with no other armor. Ain't nothing else going to work. You can't go in there with a helmet on your head talking about I'm ready to fight. No, no, no. That ain't, you just look stupid. You can't go in there with your black tar under your eyes like you about to go to the baseball game. You got to go in with your, literally close your eyes and visualize the sword in your hand, the helmet on your head, the breastplate of faith, your feet shod with the gospel. You got to have that on you and go in. God will tell you, if you say, Lord, I don't want to go in unclean, he will show you. I need you to repent from this. I still see this sin. I need you to cover this sin. Because this is a serious thing, y'all. What we get ready to go into in October, I hope y'all been doing y'all studying, y'all research. All this stuff that's getting ready to come up in October, November, we're going to need every watchman on the wall, and we're going to need every watchman to be right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to tell you this also. The Lord told me to tell you, those of you who have the midnight prayer watch, God said you are going to experience in the supernatural. He said, you are going to clearly change your scope of vision. In the prayer watch, you're going to have a change, a clear change in your scope of vision. I know some people are probably like, what's she talking about? So how many of y'all think 2020 is perfect vision? I bet you y'all heard that before. Y'all run with it and y'all say it and y'all repeat it. 2020 is not perfect vision. If you Google it, I recently went to I had an eye doctor's appointment back in March, and I found out a lot of information about the eyes. I have a pamphlet here about the eyes, and I found out 2020 is not actually perfect vision. 2020 simply is the, how do you put it? It's the scale that they use to measure how well you see. So 2020 is pretty much average. It's the average sight that the actual human can see, 2020. And that represents 20 feet. That the actual person who does not wear glasses can see about 20 feet away. 2020 is not perfect vision, because I'm going to tell you why. You have people like myself who have 20/15. And 20/15, if you Google it, it means above average vision. People with 20/15 can see something that is 20 feet away, something that would cause a regular person with 20/20 vision, they can only see from 20 feet away. Someone like me can see what you see from 20 feet from 15 feet. So I'm seeing a lot further at a shorter distance. Then you have what's even better than 20/15, which is even more rare, is something called 20/10. Someone who has 20/10 vision is considered above average, because they can see what someone who can see from 20 feet away, they can see it in 10 feet, from 10 feet away. And there was one person known that was in the Guinness Book of Records that had 25 vision. 25 is almost in sync with the eagle eye. Eagles see from a 20.5 vision, 25. And that means they almost have a panoramic view of something that is 20 feet away from them. They can see it from 5 feet away, like they're 5 feet away. And it's not blurry. So when you hear people say 20/20 perfect vision, they don't know what they're talking about. 20/20 is average vision. Now, people who have 20/15, 20/10, 25, they are considered above average vision. So when you are in the spirit, when you are on the wall, you literally tap into the eagle eye vision. When you hear people say, I'm an eagle eye prophet, usually prophets with eagle eyes, literally in the natural and in the spirit, have above average vision. Hallelujah, Jesus. They can see good in the natural and in the spirit. Hallelujah. And so when you're on the wall, God said your scope of vision will change. You will find that even in the natural, if you wear glasses, when you get on the wall, you don't need them. You don't need them. You don't need them. You can see in the spirit just fine without them. Your vision will be even better because you've tapped in from an eagle eye. You've tapped in from a prophetic perch. So literally, you are looking up high in the spirit, looking down low. And you got a good view of what's going on. You can see it. You can warn the people. You can sound the trumpet. That's part two. When you're on the wall, not only do you see, you have to sound the alarm. That's why he put a trumpet in one hand, and the pitcher in the other hand. You got to sound the alarm. You can't just be sitting there talking about, oh, I seen that. Okay, what you going to do about it? You got to bind it up. You got to sound the alarm. You got to cry loud and spare not. You got to say, Satan, I bind you. And you can't whisper it and be all like a mouse. You got to be like that trumpet. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm excited about being on the wall. I love being on the wall. I'm telling you, once you get into the spirit realm and you see what you see, you don't have no other way to want to see. You don't even want to see nothing that nobody, somebody tell you, Sister Susie, oh, she this and she that and she X, Y, and Z. You don't even need to listen to them, because if that's true, God will show it to you. Don't mistreat people because of how people describe them. If God ain't show it to you, then as far as you're concerned, it ain't never happened. Because when you see in the spirit realm, can't nothing be hidden from you. Especially if it concerns you and someone has ill intentions towards you, or there's a spirit of deception working, anything that is out to cause you harm, you will see that thing, baby. You'll see that thing coming before it even get there. You'll see it a mile away, 20 feet away. You'll see it. You'll see it afar off. And you'll be like, I knew you was coming. The Lord told me you was about to call my phone. And y'all don't believe me. I'm telling you that I had a dream one time about a pastor. And in the dream, he was giving me a word. He was giving me a word of encouragement. Do you know, when I woke up, I actually had a missed call from this same pastor. So I called him back. And I said, man of God, I just had a dream that you had a word for me. I said, I could tell you what the word you was going to give me. I could tell you what you had to tell me. He said, my God, woman of God, you are something else. He had a word for me. He said, you are something else. God will show you people coming. Man, I'm telling you, when you on the wall, you be like Nehemiah, you won't come down. You be like Nehemiah, you be like, why I'm coming to visit you? I'm not about to come visit nobody. I'm going to stay right here on this wall. I got stuff to do. I'm not coming down to visit nobody. That's what Nehemiah said. They tried and tried, and I mean they tried hard. to get him off that wall. He said, I'm not coming down. I'm not coming down. And that's what you got to do, people of God. That's right. You don't come down. You could go about your day. You could go to work. You could do your regular stuff and still be on the wall. You can still be on the wall and doing your regular stuff. You know how? Because you're staying in the spirit. You're not engaging in stuff. When you see the co-workers gossiping, you turn and go left. When you see stuff going on that you ain't got no business, you turn and go right. That way, if something being said or done to harm you, that thing will come through your radar, baby. You'll be like, oh, no. That trumpet be going off in your spirit. That discernment be going rising up like a temperature. Baby, you be like, oh, no. Mm-mm. God will warn you in dreams. He'll warn you in visions. He'll warn you in word of knowledge that you need to pray over your oldest child. He'll warn you. He'll give someone to give you a prophetic word of wisdom. Somebody, or you'll just have discernment that you need to warfare for your grandchild. Whatever. But when you on that wall, when you stay close to that wall, y'all, that's like a direct communication from the spirit realm. You can see what's brewing before it's brewed. You can see it. You can see what's brewing before it's poured out. See, what's happening is a lot of us, we're seeing things in the natural after it's poured out because we missed it while it was brewing and we could have cast it down. The Bible says, I believe it was Jeremiah chapter 2, where he said that the priests, he said, they don't let the people know that I'm there. He said, the lawmakers don't know me. He said, the pastors and the prophets, he said, they prophesy from Baal. So that's everybody, the priest, the pastor, this prophet, and the lawmakers. Well, we already know they don't know God, because look at some of the laws they done put into place. So we already know they don't know him. But my God, you expect the priests to know him, you expect the pastors to know him, and you sure enough expect the prophets. Hallelujah. But God said they don't know him. They don't know him. And because of it, they do two evils. The people do two against him. Hallelujah. So tonight, people of God, those of you who are on the wall, those of you who are praying for some things, you've been praying a long time. Your prayers might have been held up. You've been praying for some stuff. You've been waiting on God. You've been waiting on the manifestation. Your prayers is probably held up. And what you need to do is you need to begin to break that thing down. You need to pull your prayers out of the heavens. You need to pull your prayers down that are just mingling. Jeremiah chapter 2 said, the priest said not. What you need to do is start speaking the word of the Lord, because he said that's one thing they did. The priest did not say, where is the Lord? He said, and they handled the ones that handled the law knew him not. Y'all got to be careful who y'all voting for. He said, they who knew Jeremiah 2 verse 8, I think it is. He said, the people who handle the law know me not. So you got to be careful who you voting for, because the Bible says, do not be a partaker of another man's sin. You got to ask God, who can I be in agreement with? You can't just go voting because people voting and people picking sides and all this other stuff. You got to ask God, who can I be in agreement with? Because I know the lawmakers don't know you. So who can I agree with? He said the pastors transgress against him. The prophets prophesy in idolatry. That's why you don't hear me prophesying cars and houses and stuff, because God ain't spoke none of that to me. So I'm not about to speak it to you. He ain't told me that. He ain't showed me that. My dreams have been disturbing. The last thing I'm going to do is wake up and start prophesying gold, jewels, and rubies, when last night I had the warfare of the time of my life warring something for the people, because this is what's coming. You seeing fire. We sitting up here prophesying cars and houses, and God sending out his wrath with fires earthquakes, pestilence, and you talking about cars and rubies. You a lie. That ain't what he's saying. He's sending out storms. He's speaking. The sky is dark. He's speaking. People dropping by the boatloads. They burying people by the boatload. He's speaking. This is not an I'ma bless you season. This is I'ma need you to watch season. Because we living in a day where we don't know who could be next. We don't know if it's our loved ones. So if we got an advantage to be in the spirit, to see, to cover our family, to cover our loved ones, to because right now God is telling us to prepare. I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna start asking some of you, when y'all get on the wall, what is God saying? I'm gonna need y'all to tell me, because I want us to share with the people together in agreement what God is showing all of us. Because right now, what I'm hearing different prophets say, what I'm seeing different apostles say, is that God is telling us to prepare. I can't tell y'all how many dreams. In fact, not last night, but the night before last was my last dream, most recent dream that I had, where I was shopping. The Lord gave me a cart, and he was putting food and supplies in my cart. And all the stuff he put in my cart, all the supplies in my dream, I knew they were essential. All the essentials he put in my cart never overflowed. It was never empty. It never filled up. It never, you know, when you go shopping in the natural, you put a bunch of stuff in your cart. Eventually, you don't have no more space. But in my dream, my cart had more than enough space for what I needed. It never filled to the top. The more stuff that the Holy Spirit put in my cart, it looked like the cart was still empty. And then I seen 5 different lines where people were lined up with their carts. I seen some people I knew. I seen some people I didn't. I seen some people get out of the line. I seen people with empty carts. It's time to prepare. Something is coming. I'd be a lying prophet if I told you to go out and go buy this and go buy that. And God's get ready, bless you to get this. That's not what God's saying. God said, I need you right now in this season to be good stewards with your money. That's what God is saying. I need you to be good stewards with your money. I need you to put your money up, because there's about to be a long rainy day. I need you to get canned goods. What else did he tell me in my dream? Bread. He said, noodles, dry beans, noodles, canned goods, and water. He told me in my dream, because in my dream, I said, I got to get milk for all this cereal. He said, no milk. Do not get any milk products. He said, you need to get things that will last. So something is coming where I don't know if we're not going to be able to purchase stuff. I know the book of Revelation says that when you go try to buy bread, it says wheat in the King James. If you go to try to buy wheat, but in some other versions, it translates as bread. If you try to buy bread, wheat or barley, it's going to cost you a day's wages. But the oil and wine you shall not touch. The horse, that the rider that rides the pale, the black horse, is famine. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The horse that rides, the black horse and the rider, he is called famine. He who rides him is called famine. But he is not allowed to touch the oil or the wine. So that means stuff that I don't want to say the rich folks, but things that the rich folk tend to buy won't go up. The prices won't go up. But if anything like essentials, That stuff going to cost you a day's wages. It's either going to be really, really expensive, or it's going to be unavailable. And because in my dream I was rushing, it was like I didn't have a whole lot of time. I had to hurry up and get out of this store. So in a dream I was rushing. That tells me we don't have a whole lot of time. I'm telling people the month of September is prepare. Be good stewards. Prepare. If you don't have a lot of space, go get you some containers that go under your bed. They slide under your bed, out of sight, out of mind. Stack them with the 5-pound, 10-pound, 20-pound bags of rice. Stack them with noodles. In my dream, the Lord showed me beef, oodles, and noodles. I don't know why beef, because that's not a very popular flavor. Not many people eat beef noodles. But he showed me beef noodles. And the next day when I went to the Walmart, you won't believe that the chicken was all sold out. The only thing that was left on the shelf and was stacked from the floor up on the, in the aisles was beef, was the 12-pack box of beef noodles, just like I seen in my dream. So I don't know what God is saying. I mean, I do know what he's saying, but I'm telling you, something is coming. And he's specific about what to buy. He's specific about what to prepare. He's specific about what to stock up. So as he give it to me, I'm giving it to you all. You can take it how you want to take it, but the blood is off of my hands because I'm releasing it. But he said, stock up, prepare. If you're in a store and you get an unction to get batteries, not just a 2-pack, but to actually get like a 34, 46, 48 pack, get it. And you'll know it because when you go to buy it, God's going to show you where the price shouldn't be what it is. The things I've been buying usually are very expensive. I'm going to just name one item. It's black soap. I usually get black soap. Black soap is expensive, the kind that I get. I went into a grocery store the other day, and I don't know why, they were like 75% off. They were $1. I bought every last one of them. I said, Lord, should I get all of them? He said, get it. So when I see things that is normally more expensive and it's half off, 50% off, 70% off, I take that as a sign that God said, get it. I'm opening up the space. September, God said, is a space and a grace to prepare. Something is coming. Something is coming. And he said, the ones who are not prepared will be washed away. You won't have what you need. So tonight, when you're on the wall, pray about it. Ask God, what does he want you to get? Father, you said to get on the wall. You want me to watch. What is it I'm watching for? I promise you, God will show you. Ask him. He'll show you. He will show you. Why? Because it's an urgency. He needs you on the wall. He needs every last one of us on the wall. So ask him. Mother Helen, we're going to get that stuff to you. All those that said that they were going to sow into her. My Cash App is My Angel Caldwell. Again, capital letters for the first three letters, and I will pray over your seed. I will bless your seed, and speak of prosperity, word over your seed, and we will try to get those things sent to her. We want everybody to have what they need. In the mighty name of Jesus. So, Father, tonight as we close out, it's 10:20. Father, as we close out, I decree Ephesians 12, armor over your watchmen. Father, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Hallelujah, God. We thank you for the armor that you are placing on us. Hallelujah. We thank you, oh God, for the eagle anointing. We thank you, oh God, that we are perched from a prophetic view. I thank you, oh God, that you are allowing us see from a panoramic visual. We thank you, oh God, that we have clarity in our eyesight. Father, right now, I anoint the eyes of your people that they will see more clearly. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, I decree, Ephesians 6 and 12, that we do not wrestle against principalities, that we do not wrestle against powers, that we do not wrestle against the rulers of darkness of this world or against spiritual wickedness in high places, oh God. But we through your grace and through your peace, oh God, we are covered in your armor. Hallelujah. Jesus. We are covered in your armor. Wherefore, oh God, we are in your whole armor. Nothing like God's armor, because it is a whole armor. Not a half, not a partial, but a whole armor of God that we will be able to withstand in the evil day. And the evil day is near. And having done all, God, you said that we will still stand. So whatever is coming, we will not be washed away. We will still stand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, Father, right now, I pray that their loins will be girded about with truth, that you will saturate them, that their breastplate of righteousness will be on them. Father, I pray right now that the breastplate will cover against any type of heart attacks, any type of spookiness that will cause them to be afraid, to be fearful, to trigger any heart attacks or strokes. Father, put the breastplate of righteousness on them. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, and shod their feet with the preparation of the gospel, so that as they are on the wall watching, oh God, that they will not trip and stumble and into a stumbling block, into divers places, into snares and traps, but you will keep their feet. You will send angels to watch their steps. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, and I pray that above all, that you will put the shield of faith on them, that they will not waver in what they are told to do. Father, you said to prepare. You told me to warn the people. Then you said for me to watch. And then at the end of the dream, you told me to wait. Father, we are in the mid part of that warning, and we are now watching. Soon you will tell us now to wait. There will be something coming. There will be a move. There will be something that you will do. So, Father, I pray that I am being obedient to your will. I pray that I'm being obedient to what you have shown me. I pray that I'm being obedient to what you have given me. Father, I anoint my lips to speak nothing more and nothing less than what I am told to say. Father, may you honor my obedience, oh God, and may it be a reward due diligent unto me. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, as with all the people of God on the line, oh God, who are being obedient, may you honor their obedience, oh God. May it be such a sweet, savory aroma in your sight. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, so that they will be able to stand and quench every fiery dart of the wicked. Father, I pray right now that they will have their helmets of salvation on their heads. Hallelujah. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. I pray that they will pray always with prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watch with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. I thank you, oh God. I thank you, oh God. I thank you, oh God, that you have given us the spirit of not of fear, but of a sound mind. I thank you, oh God. I decree and declare Luke 10:19, that we will tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. I speak as you begin to get on the wall. I cover you in the name of Jesus with Ephesians 6:14-17. I cover you in the name of Jesus with the word Colossians 1:13, that you are delivered from the power of darkness and you are translated into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. I cover you in the word of God. 1 John 4:4 says that you overcome all, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I cover you in the blood of Jesus. I cover you in the word of God. 2 Timothy 1:7 says that you do not have the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind, and that nothing by any means shall hurt you. Hallelujah, Jesus. I speak Isaiah 53:5, that you are healed by the stripes of Jesus. Hallelujah. I decree Genesis 49:8, that my hand is upon the neck of my enemies. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I decree Psalms 23:5-6, that you anoint my head with oil, that you anoint their heads with oil, that our cups runneth over, that goodness and mercy shall follow them, not just today, but all the days of their life. Hallelujah, Jesus. I decree that you are anointed to preach. I decree that you are anointed to teach. I decree that you are anointed to heal. I decree that you are anointed to cast out devils. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I decree that you are the head and not the tail. Hallelujah. Deuteronomy 28 and 13. Hallelujah, Jesus. I decree Job 22, 28, that if I shall decree a thing, it shall be established in my life. This is the word of God. God says, I will honor my word above my name. Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Sometimes the enemy likes to become sabotaging, and he likes to sabotage and retaliate when you come down off the wall. So I decree Psalms 112 and 3, that wealth and riches are in your house and your righteousness endure forever, that he will not touch your money, that he will not touch your wealth, that he will not touch your health, that he will not touch your righteousness. Hallelujah. Father, we renounce any retaliatory spirits in the name of Jesus. We renounce any sabotaging spirits in the name of Jesus. Father, we decree Psalms 91 and 10, that no evil will befall me and no plague shall come nigh unto your dwelling. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we renounce early death and we speak Psalms 91, 16, that we will be satisfied with long life and God will show us his salvation. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. And Father, I speak Ephesians 3:16, that we are strengthened with your might and with your spirit in our inner man. Hallelujah. I speak strength into our spirit man, oh God. Not just strong vessels, but strong spirit man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we speak Matthew 5:44. We bless our natural enemies, so that we will overcome evil with good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Make your face to shine upon him and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift you up and lift up your countenance upon him, and may he give you peace. Number 624 through 26. Hallelujah. My favorite, Genesis 48 and 20, make me as Ephraim and Manasseh. That means, Lord, expand my territory. Increase me. Let me get overflow. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let your showers of blessings be upon my life. Ezekiel 34, 26. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. And Father, we thank you that our seed is blessed. My seed is blessed. Psalms 37, 26. My seed is blessed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you, oh God. We thank you, oh God. We thank you, oh God. Hallelujah. 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 Father, those who are preparing in the third watch, who are getting ready to go on the wall at midnight, Father, I pray that you incline your ear to them, that you give them strength. I pray that you will open up their eyes. I pray that you will encamp angels around them, that they will not fall off the wall, that they will not drop off the wall, that they will not be lowered down from the wall, that they will not crash, that there will be no deaths, that there will be no job loss or any other acts of evil by the demonic realm while they are on the wall. But in fact, it will be the other way around, that during this watch, the intercessors will obey the voice of the Lord. They will saturate this time with powerful spirit-led prayers. I thank you, oh God. I thank you, oh God, that as they pray and get on the wall, that they will confront every storm of destruction and distraction that is robbing you of God's blessings. Hallelujah. We pray, oh God, we thank you, oh God, that this is the hour when dreams flow. So, Father, I pray right now that that as the people slumber, as deep sleep falls upon men, Father, that you will give them dreams and visions of the night, that you said in Job 33:15, that you will open up the ears of men and you will seal in their instruction. Hallelujah. So, Father, we renounce nightmares. Hallelujah, Jesus. We renounce restlessness and we renounce the spirit of pain. Heavenly Father, we plead the blood of Jesus against all demons of the night, nightmares, torment, and sleeplessness. Father, I ask that you protect the minds of the people while we sleep, and that you put them in peace, that when they lie down after coming off the wall, that, Father, they will not be in any lack. They will not have any restlessness, but your word will be a lamp to guide their feet and a light unto their path. Father, they will lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, will keep them safe. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you. And it is so. Gideon said, it is so. And it is so. Hallelujah. And it is so. Be blessed, people of God. If you have any prayer requests, if you have any questions about tonight's Bible study, if you have anything you want me to elaborate on, I will take the time. If not, have a blessed night. I've kept Facebook on too long. I've kept you all on too long. So I'm calling it a night. Hallelujah. All right. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good night.
Good.
May God bless you.
May God bless you. I love you. I said, may God bless you too, and I love you.
Oh, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. So good. Expand the